Hello, Jessica. Welcome to the Digital Slice podcast. I'm so glad that you're here with me today. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you for having me, Brad.
Oh, my pleasure. My pleasure. Well, why don't we just dive right in and have you tell us a little bit something about yourself?
Absolutely. So I'm Jessica Embree. I'm a creative director at Tulip Media Group, and we specialize in helping businesses all over North America with their print, so custom magazines and newsletters, and their digital marketing strategies so they can convert faster on their site and grow their business. I'm also a certified StoryBrand guide for those of you who are fans of Donald Miller building a StoryBrand. Our agency is certified to help create that messaging that's really going to resonate with your core customer.
Cool. So yeah, I'm familiar with Donald Miller. I get an email from him. I think it's daily. It feels like it's daily. A little video tip or something. Very interesting. That's very cool. Where are you located?
We're in Fredericton, New Brunswick, Canada. So if you're unaware of where that is, that's just north of Maine on the East Coast.
Oh, okay. Very cool. So I understand that early on in your career, you had a business called J&J Blueberry Enterprise.
Yes. As an entrepreneur, when I was very, very young, and we had a blueberry farm growing up, and we did door-to-door salesmen.
Really? How was that?
It was great. I mean, no one could really say no to a little kid trying to sell blueberries. So we made quite a profit every summer. But it did teach us the value of money. It did teach us how to market ourselves. And I mean, we leveraged our cuteness at that age, and we were able to buy as many toys as we wanted growing up.
Very nice. At least you had a goal.
Yes, exactly.
At least you weren't just like saving for college or something like that. It was buying toys. I like that. All right. So tell me, what is a StoryBrand guide?
So StoryBrand comes from Don Miller's framework, StoryBrand methodology. And what it entails is it's a 7-point framework that really helps you kind of dive into who your core customer is and what messaging is going to really resonate with them. And that's what we're here to do at the end of the day. If your storefront is not ready for people to land on your website or your Facebook page, then you're not going to convert and make sales. And that's what we're here to do, is to make sure your storefront or your website is ready with the great messaging.
So it starts with the website messaging.
Yeah. And that's where we really kick things off with our client partners, is the website messaging. There's no sense of doing Google ads if the storefront's not ready. There's no sense of doing all this blog posts, again, if the messaging doesn't connect with the blog post. So we really make sure that everything is set to go on your website first.
Okay. And then does that messaging then sort of transfer to your, say, Google ads or Facebook ads?
Absolutely.
Is it all consistent?
Absolutely. And that's the beauty of StoryBrand. It's not just for your website. It's for everything you do. We want to make sure that your Google ads have the problem that you're trying to solve for consumers searching for you, and they have a strong call to action. You're using keywords that are driving that Google ad to make sure that the keywords on your website are also matching up with that as well. So it's a science, but at the end of the day, it's all about the messaging and making sure that it resonates.
Okay. So as a business owner, how do I discover who my core customer is?
Yeah. And it can be difficult to do. And some businesses are specialized in one thing. So it's a little bit kind of easier if you're selling insurance. People are looking to protect their home, their business. That's what they're looking for at the end of the day. But some businesses are kind of a catch-all. They sell to a lot of different markets. So it can be difficult to figure out who your core customer is. And StoryBrand breaks it down into those 7 frameworks, which is, who's your character? So it's kind of like a buyer's persona, very similar. What is their problem? What is their call to action? How do we guide them into this solution that they're looking for? What's success look like? What does failure look like? And then we kind of just use this framework to create that messaging afterwards.
Okay. So it's the beginning. The first one was sort of like a buyer persona. How do I figure that out?
So if I said, Brad, who do you typically sell to? Some people say, I sell to business owners who are between this and this age. And I'm saying, that's great. I do want to know that. But why are they coming to you at the end of the day? Is it to get marketing from you? Is it to help grow their business? Is their marketing not working for them? What is that problem? So we do want to know who the character is or that buyer persona is, but we want to take it one step further and say, how are we going to agitate the problem they're having and offer that solution up to them in an easy and clear way?
And then from that, you help develop the words, the messaging that goes on the website and social media and email and everywhere, I would imagine.
Yes, it trickles down into everything you do.
Ah, that's very interesting. That's very interesting. And so it would also trickle down into like advertising.
Yep. We use StoryBrand in all of our Google ads for ourselves and our client partners. And I remember we inherited a Google ad account from one of our current client partners. And the only thing we changed was the header of their ad and the call to action. And within a few hours, they started to see better results. So words matter. And so does the keywords behind that ad. So it's marrying those two together. And that's where you get impactful ads.
Right. And from your side of the work, how do you go about finding those right words?
So it's a science. It can be difficult to do. As a marketer yourself, you know that you can sit here all day staring at a blank piece of paper and saying, oh my goodness, where should I start? And that's where the framework comes in. It's kind of like a guide and an inspiration on to start that messaging and keep you in line on what your tone is going to be. So if I say at Tulip Media, our main problem that our businesses are having is they're wasting time and money on marketing. That's just not working for them. So I'm going to always keep that problem top to mind when I'm writing content, writing messaging. That way it aligns with everything that else that I do.
So that's really the first step is defining the problem that you're solving.
It's a big part of it. And a lot of us get so caught up in other things that we want to say in our messaging, but it does boil down to is why are people going to this business at the end of the day? If they're looking for insurance, they just want to buy insurance. Very simply, insurance can be boring. We know this. So they want to do it in a very easy way. So we need to just have that come across in the messaging.
Okay. Let's run through that framework again, a little more slowly.
Yep. So we need to define a character. We need to look at the problem the person is having, internal, and how that makes them feel. So marketing can feel frustrating. We need to have that guide center. We need to have a call to action. We need to have failure and success, and we need to have a plan. So I missed out on the plan in my first example, but we are very simple humans. If we can showcase where our customers or our visitors need to go next, they are more likely to buy from us. So have a 1 to 3 step plan on your site saying, hey, book a call with us. Then we'll discuss your marketing plans. Then you're going to start to see your business grow. Have a simple plan on your site will really allow you to convert faster.
Right. Okay. And so the third one, have a guide.
Mm-hmm.
What's that?
So a lot of businesses are great at this, is actually showcasing authority and credibility in your business. So testimonials, showcasing logos on your site. You've been in business for 35 years. It's just getting people to trust you and say, yes, we trust you with your marketing. We trust you that our house is protected, our business is protected. So it's just showcasing that credibility and authority in your business.
Okay. And then that call to action can be the book a call.
Book a call. And honestly, Brad, a lot of us get sucked into the read more and learn more. And you're laughing. Yeah. As a visitor, we're going, well, I don't want to do more work. Don says, if you have to burn calories, you're going to lose people. So just get right to the point of what this button is going to make them do. So book a call, sell my home if you're in real estate, start a quote if you're insurance, talk with our specialist, book a demo. So be very direct on what that call to action is, because if you're very ambiguous, you will probably lose some people.
Right. Yeah. And I think what you just said about trust is so important.
Mm-hmm.
I read something the other day that the point of what I was reading was that if people trust you and find you credible, it doesn't really matter what you're selling to them, they're gonna buy it. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I'm guessing that a lot of the wordsmithing that you do is around that, you know, building trust and credibility, using those words that help to do that. And like you said, doing things like having testimonials and things like that.
Yeah. And it's a very big piece of the puzzle when you're putting together your messaging. You got to remember that you have to be credible. You have to showcase your talent, your experience. So people be like, yes, I trust you with my brand. Yes, I trust you with my house. I trust you with selling my biggest asset. So showcase that credibility.
What about images and video? Mm-hmm. Where does that fit into this?
So when it comes time to do your messaging for images, showcase what success could look like in images. Sometimes we have images that are negative images, and that can be okay. But one thing I like to keep in mind is with negativity in messaging, use a grain of salt. You don't want to agitate the problem that the person's having too much. You want to be like, hey, if you don't buy insurance from us, you're going to lose everything if this happens. You want to say, you want to be reassured that you're protected in the case of something happens. So you can use negativity in your messaging, but just use a grain of salt. Mm-hmm. Not a lot.
Okay. That makes good sense. That makes good sense. Okay. So once we've gone in and we've fixed up our website and our messaging and everything is good to go, let's say we want to use Google. We want to use Google Ads. Mm-hmm. How would we use Google Ads to attract customers?
So I'll use an example. Actually, back in 2019, Tulip Media underwent a huge pivot. And I know that's such an overused word at this point in our lives, but we weren't doing any online marketing. We were doing cold calling and trade shows, and we discovered we weren't selling to who our core customer was. So we redid our messaging on our website with using StoryBrand, and we started doing Google Ads. And how we did those Google Ads is we did a keyword analysis. So I can have really great messaging, but if no one can find me because of the key terms that they're searching in Google, your Google Ads are going to kind of be useless. So that's what we did. We did that keyword analysis that will fuel our Google Ads, and we used our StoryBrand messaging that's going to resonate with our core customers so they click onto our website.
Through the use of the keywords.
Exactly. Yeah.
And then so, you already had your messaging ideas because you've done the StoryBrand. And then you took those words, created the ads, mm-hmm. included the keywords.
Yep.
And then you were good to go.
Yep, exactly. And for example, marketing agencies near me is a keyword we use that when someone types it in, that's when our ad pops up. You probably might use the same keywords in your location too. So different keywords showcase and what you're needed for what you need for an ad. But one thing with keywords is you have to be careful. You can't be too ambiguous. A great example of that is we have a fire truck manufacturer as a client. And if we use fire trucks for his keyword for his Google Ads, he would get people looking for toys. He'd get people looking for just pictures of fire trucks. So we have to be careful when we're looking at keywords that they're not too generic, that they actually talk to the niche or the product that we're trying to sell.
Interesting. That's an interesting example. I hadn't really thought about that. Do Google Ads work for everyone?
No, and Google Ads isn't for everyone. We've seen great success for most of our clients, but if you're a company that your main core customer isn't on Google, then Google Ads won't work for you. And you have to ask yourself, where are my core customers finding information? I read something the other day that TikTok is taking over on Google searches. People are searching more on TikTok than they have ever been before. So if your main clientele is on TikTok, do TikTok content. Don't do Google Ads unless they're on Google.
Right. That makes good sense. Where does social media come in? Where does social media marketing, I guess, would be a better way to ask, come into play with all of this?
I think social media is a great part of your marketing strategy. I always have and I always will. Just because it gives you a space to put out short content, like short content. So if you're on Instagram, you're updating those photos. If you're on TikTok, you're putting out content that's relevant. It's a great way to keep top of mind with your clients, and that they can always be going back to your brand and seeing your brand through scrolling, because we all scroll at the end of the day.
Yeah, that's very true. Okay, so we're doing this. I'm assuming our ultimate goal is to get people to find us, whether it's social media or our website or whatever, and then convert. So talk a little bit about conversion strategies and maybe some automation with that.
Absolutely. So your conversion strategy is different for everyone. Tulip Media, for example, we love to make it easy as possible for people to get in touch with you. So that is usually through an automation like a Calendly link or a HubSpot link. Sometimes it's through an email series. You mentioned you get an email from Dawn every day. That's slowly but surely going to kind of convert you into a different type of customer with him. So it really depends on what industry you are in and also what is your intent behind the call to action.
Okay. So let's say I'm trying to get somebody to book just a phone call with me so that I can talk to them about their marketing problems.
Yep.
What would be my conversion strategy for that?
Probably for you, I would recommend just a quick phone call, because a lot of us fall into the trap. We ask for their hand in marriage first and not, you know, dating them and letting them know that they can trust us. So doing a quick call, or actually a lot of marketing agencies do what we call downloadable PDFs. So sometimes people are not willing to get on a phone call, and that's all right. That's just the world we live in today. So sometimes it's download this free checklist to see if your marketing's working. And then you're getting their email from that and putting them into a drip campaign. So really, it depends. But for you, it'd probably be a quick call. And then, yeah, sure, throw in that downloadable PDF too, just in case someone's not ready to actually talk to you today.
Right. So we have to date first.
Yeah.
I'm so impatient.
I know. And a lot of businesses are like that. We're like, okay, just here's the contract. And some people are like, whoa, whoa, whoa. I need to talk to you first and make sure everything lines up first.
Right. What if I'm selling a product?
It can work for a product too. So that's where we see those demos. Back to the fire trucks. Those are very niche products. They're $500,000 products. So booking a call doesn't necessarily work for them. And what we ended up finding out is if we can help them with the request for proposal process, the fire truck chiefs who are buying these fire trucks, that's when our conversion strategy starts to turn around. So we did everything we could to automate getting those fire chiefs before their request for proposal and helping them with those proposals. So that's what our conversion strategy was around for the fire truck manufacturer.
Oh, interesting. Very interesting. Okay. Kind of going back a minute to the website. So optimizing my website, if I want to optimize my website, I'm a business owner. Mm-hmm. We're going to go through those seven steps. We're going to come up with the language that needs to go on the website. Mm-hmm. What about search engine optimization?
I'm so glad you asked this. So you can have a really pretty website, but if the back end of your site doesn't work, no one's going to find you. We had a client came to us and they're like, we just spent thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars on this new website. And I was like, it looks beautiful, but you are missing everything in the back end for search engine optimization. You do not have any headers, meta descriptions. There's no alt text. So yes, have great messaging, have a great looking website, but make sure you are meeting all the SEO optimizations that you can be.
Because it's the SEO that's going to help you be found in the search engines.
Exactly. So it's a balance. So a lot of the messaging we put out for our clients and ourselves is, yes, it goes back to StoryBrand, but we're also looking at what keywords people are looking for and weaving that into the messaging.
Right. That makes great sense. Then from there, what do we do to sort of optimize our marketing?
So our process is usually that keyword analysis first, because it does trickle down into everything we do, just like the story brand. So we're making sure that anytime we do a blog post, it's SEO optimized and it has those keywords in it. We're making sure when we're creating that marketing on the story brand and the messaging, we're making sure those keywords are being used. Those keywords are being used in your Google ads. So we're optimizing your marketing every step of the way using two things, the keyword analysis and the story brand messaging.
Are business owners sometimes surprised at what the end product you come up with is?
No, and the reason for that is because when we're going through the story brand exercise, it's an exercise together. So we're on a call just like this, and we are picking your brain, and we're going through together and saying, okay, what does this problem make them feel? Are they frustrated their marketing's not working? Are they overwhelmed that there's too many marketing strategies for them to choose from and they just don't know where to go? So we're picking their brain, and at the end of it, we're kind of being on the same page. And then that's when we showcase what that messaging looks like and say, here's what your website should look like. And from there, it's that transparency and open communication that we've had that we are all on the same page.
Right. Okay. Yeah, that makes good sense. So how do you feel about the importance of customer retention?
So you fight really hard to get new customers, but there's no sense, you can't grow unless you keep those customers that you fought hard for. So if you lose one customer, now you have to get two to grow, not just one. So customer retention is really, really important. You want to make sure that you're setting those expectations. You have that upfront contract. So this is what your program is. This is the results we expect. These are the current benchmarks you're having. And from here on month 1, 2, and 3, this is what we're going to be doing. Having that communication and setting those expectations helps keep those customer retention. And of course, customer service. Treat your customers like gold, because they're your biggest referrals too.
Yeah, they are your biggest referrals too, especially when we're talking about the importance of social media and all of those places you want to have happy customers. Sort of acting as your unpaid marketing department, getting the word out for you. Okay, is there a optimal size of website? Certain number of pages that you recommend or don't recommend?
Every industry and client's different. So for example, insurance agencies, we have a lot of insurance agencies as clients, and they sell business insurance, cyber insurance, personal insurance. So the list goes on. And yes, they have a home page, but they probably have sub pages for each of those individual insurances too. So it's really dependent on what industry you're in. If you need more pages to go down into those sub pages, that's perfectly fine.
Okay, good. That makes sense. As long as all those pages are search engine optimized and uses all the keywords and
exactly
has so the right messaging.
Make sure you have those headers, those meta descriptions, and you're writing good and original content.
Right. Great. Okay, wow. So the story brand concept, I mean, is really interesting to me. The businesses that you work with, do they like this concept? Is it hard for them? Is it easy for them? What's the reception?
So when businesses come to us saying that they want to go through the story brand methodology with us, we make it as easy as possible. So we're going to sit down with you for an hour or two and pick your brain about your core customer. From there, we're going to create all the messaging. We'll create a website mock-up of what that messaging should look like applied. Well, usually these clients, they're also doing Google ads for them too. So we try to do all that heavy lifting. Now, a lot of us, if you're like Tulip Media, we started out just reading the book before getting our certification in this. So we did it on our own. So your messaging changes over time. You'll start to see, and that's one thing to keep in mind is, you're not one and done. You have to keep optimizing your website for keywords, for messaging, because things change. So we try to make it easy as possible. But I know if you're doing StoryBrand on your own, like we did when we first started out, it can be a challenging thing. The hardest marketing you do is for yourself because you have what we call the curse of knowledge, those horse blinders. We have been in this business for so long, we can't see what that messaging should be. And it makes it difficult. And that's why we sometimes need that third party perspective.
Right. Right. Who are the members that you at Tulip Media mainly work with?
So we work with a vast variety of people. We have insurance agencies, like I mentioned, we have the fire truck manufacturer, we have jewelers, we have nurseries, garden nurseries, we have technologies. So we've worked with all different types of industries. Right now, our biggest clientele would probably be in the insurance industry, though.
Okay. So with all that vast array of customers, your core customer was kind of challenging to figure out, huh?
Absolutely, Brad. Because you're sitting here going, well, they're having a different problem than this person. They're having a different problem than this person. But at the end of the day, you kind of have to get past that and say, they're all having problem with marketing. And that's what we put our messaging around, is they're tired of wasting time. They're tired of wasting money. They don't have the resources or people to do it in-house. And that's where Tulip can come in. So it's finding that common path and kind of going from there.
Right. So we talked a little bit about Google ads. Have you had success with Facebook ads, Instagram ads, those kinds of social media ads?
Yeah, so we've done social ads before. And one thing I like about social ads, a pro to them, is while people are scrolling, that brand awareness can come. And if it's really good content and valuable content, that's when they're going to click and go to your site. The con of that is social media marketing is interruption marketing. So we're trying to look at what our friends and family are up to. We're just trying to look at the latest TikToks. We're trying to connect with new people on LinkedIn. So that interruptive marketing sometimes isn't as effective as Google ads. However, there's always a place for it. Right now we're running LinkedIn ads because we want to target a certain title, a certain industry, and LinkedIn ads is the way to do that.
LinkedIn ads are oftentimes a little bit more expensive, though.
They are. And that's something to keep in mind. The difference in costs from social to Google can be a little bit more. However, if you know strategically that's where your core customer is, and you know that you have a certain budget and you have a certain niche, then LinkedIn ads can be worth it, or Facebook ads can be worth it.
And when you work with a client, you help them figure out where their core customer is.
Absolutely. Yeah. We'll sit down and say, okay, your core customer is fire chiefs. They're probably not on social media all day. They're probably not on social media looking for fire truck manufacturers. They're on Google. So that's where we kind of have to go through that little exercise and say, okay, no, this is where you need to allocate most of your money, or this is where we need to allocate most of your strategy.
Well, I hope you're right about the fire chiefs not being on social media all day, just in case there were a fire. I mean, we don't want to drag them away from Facebook. All right. Well, this has been really interesting. What would be one or two or three takeaways? What do you want people to really take away from what we've talked about?
One big takeaway is make sure your storefront is ready. So you can do all of these different Google ads, blogging, but if your storefront is not ready, your homepage, your website is not ready for people to call you or book a demo, then your marketing might fall flat. So make sure your website is ready. And you can do that just with a quick, what Don Miller calls a grunt test. Go on your website, look at your website in 5 seconds and see if it meets the grunt test, which is, does it tell them what you do? Does it help them get across how that can help them survive and thrive? And does it have a call to action? And do this on your mobile, because desktop and mobile are very different. And sometimes you might not realize the different responsiveness.
Yeah, that's great. That's yeah, very important, that grunt test. And I'm kind of hesitating there today because I just was on mobile looking at something and it looked totally different. And you realize when you have these websites that are supposed to be mobile friendly and mobile responsive, and then you look at it and things aren't lined up right, or there's all these pictures at the top. You got to scroll before you even get to the messaging. All those things are so important in mobile. And are you finding statistically that a lot of people are using mobile to find your clients online?
It's interesting. Again, it goes down to what industry they're in. So for as a marketing agency, mobile is high up on our list. As a fire truck manufacturer, desktop is more higher. So it depends on the industry, but mobile is still the vast majority for most of the clients we work with.
Yeah. So like, what about in the insurance industry?
We have a mix, but mostly mobile.
Mostly mobile.
That's why that start a quote needs to be right top center.
Yeah, I would think, I guess, if I was looking for life insurance, would I be scrolling on my phone or looking on my desktop?
Yeah.
I don't know. Me personally, I'm on my phone so much that it's probably on my phone that I'm doing.
Yep.
At least initially. Sometimes then I'll find it a little more difficult to do what I need to do on my phone, and I'll have to go to my desktop to finish it. But yeah, so that's important. But the search engine optimization isn't any different for mobile.
No, but you do still have to keep that top of mind when you're laying stuff out. But in our book, Double Sales, Zero Salespeople, that I wrote with our co-founder, we were having a huge problem with our Google ads, and I could not figure out what was going on. And this was a case study in there. And finally, I opened it up on my mobile phone. I said, oh, we were doing a Google ads for newsletter publishing. But when you open it up on your phone, the first thing people saw was magazine publishing. And then you scroll down, it had newsletter publishing. So just flipping that automatically went from getting one lead a week for newsletters to getting one lead a day. So little tweaks like that can make a huge difference. So always keep in mind when you launch a new page, look on your mobile.
Yeah.
And your tablet too, actually.
Yeah. Yeah. That's good advice. So you kind of glossed over this book that you mentioned writing, or not glossed over, but sort of speedily gave us the title and all. What was the name of the book?
Double Sales, Zero Salespeople. So it's the journey of Tulip Media and how in 2018, 2019, we pivoted. Again, we were doing cold calling, trade shows, spending thousands of dollars on a push strategy where no one was raising their hand about the problems that we were trying to and solutions we were trying to give them. And we just turned everything around with using that story brand methodology, using Google ads. So it's going through what we did for our business, the success we've seen, and also case studies we have with a lot of our clients.
Okay, great. I will definitely put a link to that in the show notes so that people can find that book, because it sounds very interesting. Mm-hmm. I'm going to go look for it right now when we're done too. I'm going to do that on mobile though, by the way, just tossing that out to you. Where else can people find you?
So if you want to go to tm.media/doublesales, there you can see, get a free chapter of our book. You can buy the book, or if you want to just chat with me for 10 to 15 minutes, I can be your sounding board. You can throw ideas at me. I can just be there for you if you need someone to talk to about marketing for 15 minutes.
Okay. Can people find you on social media too?
Absolutely. So LinkedIn, Jessica Embree, you can find me there. Facebook, Instagram, you can find all of our Tulip Media pages as well. Again, if you need us, book that free call with us and we're happy to discuss and help you in any way we can.
Okay, great. Jessica, thank you so much. I appreciate you taking time to educate all of the listeners and me today. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
You bet.